Father's worth, the worth and the value of Christ Jesus, far surpasses anything that can be measured in worth and value within the realms of the earthly. Of course, see, it's just some small part. What we got right now, just some small part of all he's done. You know what I'm saying? So his worth so supersedes, obviously, some small part of what he's done, doesn't it? And he took, and in his loving kindness, he poured out all of his worth. That's his glory, his splendor, his majesty, his value. Honor is a value word. It's a quantifiable word of value. That's what honor is. Hallelujah. That's what glory is. And I pray tonight that you be so touched by the power of the Holy Ghost that you will not start making something about your life more of worth than that which he's been willing to honor us with. You'll begin to value that which he's given far above all other things and possess it. Hallelujah. That you're not sitting over in the camp of those who have no home in Povertyville, looking off in the distance at the realms of splendor and glory with a wishful eye, longing that maybe someday you might attain into such a place of living. But you'd rather move in. You possess it. Hallelujah. Well, you know, I don't like the praise to stop. I want an atmosphere of praise. I'm going to tell you this. Listen, we love every one of you. We're just happy that you're here. But you've got to understand our intent. Our intent is to get you over into a realm where you literally have flowing out of you the very existence of your being is an atmosphere of praise. Amen. That you're so full of praise. Yes. You know, if you would learn how to enter into praise, you could go to bed at night and praise wouldn't even cease. You just hear songs going off. You can't even shut them off. It's not even coming from your mind, because your mind could shut them off. It's not even coming from your mind and your thoughts, because your mind and your thoughts would have to dictate the words. And the words go in a different direction. You sit there, you listen, you lay there and learn and hear praise sounding out. I don't think there's any greater vision, any greater revelation, any greater experience than being able to enter into that realm of just worship, just praise, which really is just this life of joy and thanksgiving. And the life of joy and thanksgiving, that worship and praise, is all centered around the Father, because he's the source of it. And he's just so full of love for us, and he's just so full of goodness, and he's just so full of all of this abundance that we just sit there and just continually get overwhelmed with the intensity of all that he has, and it just keeps flowing out. And it keeps flowing in more than we can receive, and it keeps flowing out beyond all measure, so that all you can do is express it like rivers. And we just want you to live in this. It's called the good life. And we want to just point out the things that would rob you of the good life. And we want to show you where Satan, the rebellious imp who would try to come and block you from this abundant life, we want to show you how to properly deal with him. We want to show you how to properly smack him.
Yes.
Hallelujah. With the authority of the word of God, run him off like a dog.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Like the rebel and the liar that he is against all the truth. Huh?
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, I love it how Paul said it to the Romans. He said, you shall very soon smash Satan under your feet.
Yes.
You need to crush him very soon. Just stand fast in what God has given you. Yeah, you got a lot of opposition. And you know, I think about the revival that really, in many respects, the early church birthed with their own blood, where they had to go in as whole families into various different arenas and coliseums and be persecuted and made into human torches, made crucified, stomped by elephants for sport, torn apart by horses for sport, eaten by lions so everybody could get a good jolly laugh out of it all. And out of their blood, the nations that and the cultures and the kingdoms that persecute them was overthrown by the power that is in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. It's true. Hallelujah. At one time, all the nations of the earth trembled under the name of Jesus Christ, where the majority of humanity was. It's true. And men backslid and began to turn the glory of God into things that were for their own profit and shame, and began to spoil it all and ruin it all. And then, you know, just all history is just... But you know what? We have another opportunity. Nothing's changed. God in His glory and His majesty still loves as much as He's always loved, still has the same plan and purpose for humanity, and has today a greater manifestation of His power ready to be revealed. And the reason I say that is because the increase of His government, there is no end. And so if you plot this, okay, you plot this power of government of God on the y-axis, okay, and on the x-axis, time, where are we at now? It's greater. Does that make sense to you right now? Yeah. Okay. Hallelujah. It's good theology. Praise God. Hallelujah. There's an increase with God. There's an increase. God wants you to increase with His increase. He wants you to grow with His growth. Hallelujah. He's got a supply for you. We want to show you how to hook up and stay hooked up. And understand how subtle the enemy is to try to disconnect you. I tell you, the only thing you want to disconnect from is the world and all the stuff that goes along with it, and all the, you know, all the strife and envy and all the, you know, condemnation and guilt and shame and accusation that the enemy would try to put on you personally and then try to get you to put on everybody else. And that's what everyone lives in. My God, quit that. Because all that does is how to disconnect you from a divine connection. You want to disconnect from that so you could connect with God, okay?
Hallelujah.
Pretty simple.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, why don't you just go ahead and be seated, and let me just minister to you for a while. Now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I take authority over all sickness and disease, and I command it to go and depart right now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have pain in your body, it has no right to be there. It's a demonic affliction. In the name of Jesus, I command it to go. Somebody says, well, what about the mechanistic physiology and physiological chemistry and biochemistry and the nature of the various things that we can explain in terms of bodily function and organs, endocrine system, nervous system, circulatory system? I'm saying not nonsense. No, the half about it. I like the story that is told, and this is a true story because these are holy men of God that told the story, and they know as well as anybody else knows that all liars have their part in the lake of fire, and lying ain't gonna get you anywhere down the road. It's gonna get you, rather, you know, it's gonna stop you cold in your tracks. But at any rate, Smith Wigglesworth, who became known as really the apostle of faith, before he stepped into the baptism of the Holy Ghost and flowing in the power and the glory of God, he came down with appendicitis, and it had erupted, and it was bad, and sepsis was setting in. And the doctor that was coming to take care of him said, listen, it's too advanced. Doesn't matter if we go and try to take it out. It ain't going to do any good. Just try to comfort him, make him feel better, because, you know, there's nothing we can do. And so one of his friends that came in, preacher, a Holy Ghost preacher, full of the power of God, didn't give Satan any wiggle room for if it be thy will. You know what I'm saying? Okay, good. Came in, ran upstairs before his wife could get, before Smith's wife could talk to him or anybody else could talk to him, jumped on Smith and commanded the devil come out of him in the name of Jesus. And Smith's trying to get a word out to try to explain to him the physiological state which he was in and give him, you know, the medical prognosis that was delivered to him so that he might understand, you know, how hopeless he was. And all this man of God did was command the devil to go out, and his appendix was completely cured. And he went on, of course, you know, to do all the things that he did in God. Praise the name of the Lord. Just simply because he was willing to sell out. I mean, he fought people who were baptized in the Holy Ghost. He spoke against them and didn't believe in it because he was really persuaded that what he believed was true and what was being taught and propagated was false and error. But all of a sudden, one day, the power of God came on him, and he too got filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave him utterance. And understand what he was doing was he wasn't arguing from a religious point of view. He was arguing from a passion and a consecration that he had to the Lord. It was genuine. His argument was genuine. It was proven later that his argument was genuine, because as soon as he was touched from above, he went and he labored more than everybody else of his contemporaries. There's a lot of, this is the way it is repeated over and again in generations, where that's, you know, there's a great mass of people get touched by the power of God, but just one or two really labor, go with it and run with it and do everybody else's work almost. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, you'll begin to do the work that God has given you to do, and that you'll then allow the Holy Spirit to cause you to excel. You'll receive more. He's got more for you to have. He makes it literally, he makes all grace. You know, Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. And that, and you know, he went on and described to the Romans that they could only minister out of the dimension of grace that was given to them. But he also calls us to realize that an abundance of grace, really all grace, was a product of obedience. And he made it really, and he simplified it even when he talked about in terms of the way that we give. And I don't believe that giving is just limited to finances, although that is the application in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 that Paul gives. That is the application. He's talking about if you sow sparingly, you should reap sparingly. And if you sow generously, you should reap generously. But I certainly do believe the application, and even look at it even in a greater dimension, of the way that we sow our lives, generously or sparingly. The way that we give ourselves to the things of the kingdom. And he says that God will cause all grace to abound unto you. And literally that word abound, everywhere you find it, is a Greek word that literally means more than you can contain. Abound. He will cause you to have more grace than you can contain. Okay? He will cause all grace. And now that's really a big word. He will cause every dimension of grace more than you can contain to abound unto you, that you may have all sufficiency in a few things or some things. No. All things. That's a whole lots of alls. God's into the all stuff. He's into the abundant stuff, the supply stuff, no limits. God's got no limits. We put limits on God by our ideas, by our doctrines, by our beliefs. We get stuck in our ideas and doctrines and beliefs, then we'll get everybody else stuck. And when somebody comes along and tries to get me stuck, they can't get me stuck, and then they get all upset at me because I won't be stuck with them. And then somehow I'm bad in the process, because that's just the way of the world. Don't get stuck, because if you get stuck, you're going to try to impose that on everybody else, and you're going to be upset when you see somebody else who's not stuck. Well, when you see somebody else is not stuck, don't get upset. Join them.
Yeah.
Join them. Recognize that God doesn't have limits. He doesn't put limits. He doesn't relegate some people to spiritual poverty and other people to spiritual riches. Some people are rulers with him in Christ Jesus, and other people are just serfs, you know, just slaves, you know, slaves of all slaves. Some of you, you know, you're created in God to sit on a throne. The others are created to dig in my garden. That's nonsense. You know, God has created us together in Christ Jesus. Praise God. There's no big I's and little U's. Hallelujah. He just made it every one of us. He's privileged anybody, whosoever will, come be a part of the family. Yeah. And if there's anything we hate to see is hierarchy among brothers and sisters. You know, my goodness, the family, everybody ought to just be equal in this love. And God has truly made us equal, and people don't get it. When Father talks about unity, he's talking about equal. He's talking about equal in a way that is so beautiful, because it's an equal that is in oneness. He talks to us about an equalness with him, a oneness with him, even though he's always God. And there's no way that when we're beginning to talk about oneness that we do away with that, because we find all of our life in him. Without him, we don't have any life. So he's the author of the life. But nonetheless, we find ourselves one with him. And I want to talk to you about this tonight. I want you to get a hold of the gospel. And the gospel fundamentally is that you now exist in him. And outside of him, you don't exist at all. And that in him, you have everything that he possesses. It's about time that God's people quit giving Satan wiggle room in their life, because he's a rebellious imp. And if you acknowledge him in any way, he's going to absolutely run havoc in your life. If there's any place that people need to come to, God's people need to finally come to a place where they give no place to the devil, and especially primarily to begin with, in their theology. Because I look around and I see a lot of people that have been born again, born from above. They've been brought into Christ Jesus. And they're constantly saying that they're not in Him by their actions, by their deeds, by their attitudes, by the things that they think, the things that they say. It's about time that your conversation and that your speech begins to give way to the Word of God. Because I'm telling you, your faith is never going to go further than your confession. Your faith will always be hooked up with your confession. For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. That faith runs right there in the same way. The Lord says, recite this word day and night. Literally, I know that in King James and some other versions, it said in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8 said, and verse 6 said, meditate on the word day and night. But He's literally saying, recite the word day and night that you may observe to do everything that is written here. Then you shall make your way prosperous. Then you shall have the kind of success that God described in His word that you have. As long as you're believing other things and thinking other things, listen, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And I'm wanting to know what's in your heart. I pray that Christ Jesus is in your heart. I pray that the word of God is in your heart. It is the wellspring and the source and the supply of your whole spiritual being, even as your natural physical heart is a wellspring and a supply of all of your natural physical human being. You hear me, what I'm saying? It's the very center, as it were, that supplies every part of the being. Neurosystem won't work without the blood. Endocrine system won't work without the blood. Tissue in your body will not survive without the blood. Oxygen, in other words, and all the other elements of life are not going to be delivered without the blood. And that is ultimately supplied by this wonderful thing, this wonderful organ that we physically call the heart, which God then takes that and uses that to help us understand that is actually, in a similar sense, the way that the inner man begins to function and where He's going to set up His tabernacle. See, God can set up His tabernacle in my heart. God created a new covenant. Jesus came and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is given to you for your sins to be remitted." Now, I want you to understand this. I just going to quote it to you, Matthew 26:26, right? I want you to understand. I want you to track with me tonight on the covenants. And I want you to understand what covenants are all about. And really what they are is they are a seal of a contract of relationship between us and God. And God gave to Abraham a covenant. And within the framework of that covenant, there was the pouring forth of the blood. And there was the representation of what Jesus Christ would give of Himself, His blood and His body. I want you to consider with me what God made Abraham to be inside of that covenant. God made him a Lord over everything. He did. You can read about it in Romans chapter 4. In fact, I was recently translating a verse of scripture in Genesis chapter 20, and it's just a simple verse of scripture, and it's mostly translated, and it was really talking about Abimelech. You know, when Abimelech took Sarah, you know, from Abraham, God appeared to him and said, "You're dead. You are a dead man. You have a prophet of mine's wife in your house, and you're dead." And, you know, and of course, you know the response. But nonetheless, at the end of it, he literally says, "You, she is the wife of a Lord." And most of the translations translated, "She is the wife of another man." But literally, the Hebrew says, "She's the wife of a Lord." And God made him a Lord. He made him a Baal, a Lord. He made him a ruler. He gave him an inheritance that can be discussed on so many different ways. He says, "Abraham, look." He said, "I'm going to give it all to you." He says, "Go look to the east, look to the west, look to the north, the south. It's all yours. Wherever the sole of your foot treads, that's yours. I'm going to take your seed. I'm going to multiply it. And I'm going to cause all the nations of the earth to be blessed through you." And he goes on and on and on of all the things that God made Abraham to be in the covenant. You know, you can look at, rather than me having you turn the verses of scripture and look at them right now, you're just going to have to listen to me and go look at them later. Go listen to what God says about Abraham as the one who is the heir of the worlds. The heir, not world singular, heir of the worlds, plural. God's got worlds. He had a world that then was overflowed with water and perished. There is a world that is now and exists. It is reserved unto the day of judgment and that fire that would bring forth a new creation of a new heaven and a new earth. And then there's a world to come. There's the world that God is going to bring to pass when he renovates the heavens and the earth with fire. And he comes, and the new Jerusalem comes down out of heaven and sets up upon the earth. And in this new heaven, this new earth, wherein dwells only righteousness, God Almighty reigns forever, and the Lamb Christ Jesus, and all of us with him, and in a beautiful society and a beautiful kingdom of God culture that will never have any end. And you think about what all God gave to Abraham in that covenant. You think about what God was to Abraham. I mean, goodness, Abraham had to take care of himself. He told Sarah, he said, Sarah, listen, when we go from here, let this be your kindness to me. You can find this in Genesis chapter 20. Anywhere we go, you so beautiful, this paraphrase, you so beautiful that they're going to kill me because of you. So you just tell them that I'm your brother and you're my sister so that they leave me alone and don't kill me for your sake. I mean, come on. She was his sister. They both had the same father, but they had different mothers. That you can also see. It's probably Genesis chapter 20, probably right around, I don't know, verse 9 or verse 10. And to marry your sister, she must have been beautiful, okay? She had to be way over the top. And somebody said, well, isn't that incest? No, it's not. Not in terms of the culture and what was defined at that time. And did it result in some kind of problem, children? No, absolutely not. And there's a lot of reasons for that, but I'm not going to espouse my theories of genetics to you tonight, okay? Because mine look a lot different than it did take 50,000 years for and 100 or 100,000 or, you know, 10 million years for certain mutations to take place. And I'm not going to go into all of that tonight, but I got some serious explanations for all this weird thinking that people have, you know, especially all these scientists who want reproducible results and evidence for anything, any theory that is espoused before it's believed. And yet they describe whole populations of species that have no resemblance of existence. You know, my goodness, are you with me? I'm not going to get into that tonight. I'm going to leave it alone. It's kind of pulling on me because I can hear some people saying, tell me about it, but I'm not going to. I'm not going to do it tonight. Somebody recently said, man, you ought to write a book on this, especially a children's book, and help people understand where these theories ultimately were derived. What was the premise of the theories? The premise of the theories, such as the Enlightenment, when men ultimately said there can be no supernatural explanation of anything that we see in creation. We must be able to explain it by some kind of mechanism that isolates God from the picture. Well, when that's your initial premise, you're going to end up in the wrong place. And so, you know, a lot of ideas, when you have initial variables and initial constants that you set forth, ultimately that drives forward what you're ultimately going to end up with in your conclusions. You need to be a little bit broader of a thinker, you narrow-minded people. Okay, let me turn this thing back around on you, because I got more evidence with me than you have with you. And this is true. So I'm saying that, I'm sure for somebody on the web, I'm sure nobody in here is all puzzled still with such stupidity, okay? But at any rate, back to Abraham, okay? And, you know, it just didn't work out that way. And there's a lot of evidence that there was no problem even 3,400 years ago with this kind of marriage arrangement. But nonetheless, back to the point that I'm really trying to drive home is with the covenant, there comes a great inheritance. There comes a great position. God said he's a mighty prince with me. He's my prince. He's watching over him. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, anybody who touches God's anointed, the one that God's in covenant with, is in serious trouble, just like Abimelech. Abimelech, you are a dead man. You are not everything. And immediately, all kinds of problems set upon his entire house. And of course, you know Abimelech's response, Lord, are you going to destroy a righteous nation? For you know, in the purity of my heart and in the cleanness of my hands, I did this thing. And God said, yes, I know you did it in the purity of your heart. Therefore, I restrained you from your sin. Isn't that beautiful? Oh, I could preach a long time on that. Are you listening to me? I found that every verse in the Bible's got some gigantic doctrines being exposed to us. Are you with me? Hey, mind, when you got to walk with God, you got protection. When you got to walk with God, you don't need to defend yourself. You got God with you. And when And always there's going to be this challenge, because really what's going to happen is what we really believe on the inside, what we've really been willing to totally be sold out to, is going to come out in the moments of crisis. And we're going to find out whether or not we really believe God is going to be our defense, or whether we got to rise up and defend ourselves, whether or not God is going to be our protector, our provider, and the list goes on. But he's with the covenant given to us so much. I mean, when you look at the covenant then, when Moses took and sprinkled all the people with the blood and enjoined unto them the commandments of the covenant, and God made them a holy nation. He made them a treasure people, and he placed them above all the nations of the earth, and he gave them the gift of holiness, those that were separated unto him, those that would represent him to all the nations of the world. Once again, taking Abraham's covenant now and spreading it out in a glorious and a grandiose way among all of those who were his descendants in Israel. And then we come to that day where the Lord Jesus is there at Passover. And at Passover, it was the time, of course, when God brought Israel out of Egypt and he delivered them from their bondage. A bondage that represents a state, the state that we were in before we came to know the Lord Jesus Christ, a state that all mankind are in because of the sin of Adam. Instead of Pharaoh being the one who is the king, it's the satanic realm, it's the demonic power, the one called the devil, who is the king and the ruler over that realm. And so the Passover was all about God that night delivering them with a mighty and a strong hand. And what was at the very center of the Passover was the blood of the Lamb and what we call the bread of affliction, the unleavened bread. And that night when Jesus was there with the disciples, and they go, oh, bug-eyed, they don't know what's going on. I mean, because we're hard of hearing. It takes us a long time to get it. And in fact, if it all is, until we get baptized in the Holy Ghost, we never get it. We're still trying to figure it out. Think. And think is never going to get you anywhere. You're going to have to be motivated by the Holy Ghost that will move you beyond your thinker. Because if you're saved based on your thinker, you have no hope. Man, if God is ultimately going to receive us in the kingdom based on what we know, we're all miserably lost, okay? Because there's just no headway there, dear people. Yeah, most people in this place, and of this place we call life, in this world, they can't think themselves from day to day in how to just, you know, keep their head above their bills. I mean, that's pathetic. But you know what? God will give you wisdom, hallelujah, and you won't have to live that way anymore. God, the Holy Ghost will fill you, and you begin to move under his inspirations. You take your spirit out of your body, and your body is going to lay down dead and lifeless. You take the Holy Spirit out of the context of our lives, and we are going to be lifeless when it comes to those things that God has purposed to do. And oh, it's wonderful, the motivation, the inspiration, the unction, the wisdom, the insight, the ideas, what we can think about them in just a natural, kind of thinking, you know, the ideas that came for the telephone, the ideas that came for the light bulb, the ideas that came for the car, the ideas that came for all of these things that we have come to enjoy and depend upon, that has brought to us all these various different comforts. But now excel that over into the divine and think about what the Holy Ghost wants to be doing to your mind all of the time. Hallelujah. He wants to be flooding you with things of certainty about the ways of God. He wants to teach you about heaven. You've been taught all your life about earth. You've been taught all your life about the physical properties and the natural functions of life. God wants to talk to you about heaven. He wants to teach you about the unlimited realm of divine power and the unlimited realm of divine glory, how to live free from sin, how to live free from sickness, how to live free from disease, how to live free from torment, how to live free from fear, how to live and never see death. Jesus said, he that believes on me shall never see death. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Somebody said, oh, you're saying that you're never going to die? You're going to die, but you won't see death at death. You'll rather you see angels at death. Praise God. You'll see life at death. I'm telling you right now, I already know what's going to happen when I lay down to die and breathe out my last breath. I'm going to be seeing, I'm going to be looking right up into glory. I'm going to be reaching out. I'm going to want it to end quickly. Because I'm not going to see death. I'm not going to see the pain. I'm not going to see the suffering. I'm not going to see the torment. I'm not going to see the way of the transgressor, which is hard. I'm not going to eat the fruits of death, of the pains of death. Hallelujah. I've been delivered from the pains of death. This is the new covenant. I'm really kind of jumping ahead. I want to spend some more time with Moses, but I'm just here now, so I'm going to stay here. This new covenant, We think about this new covenant. This new covenant has brought us into a place where we're heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus. And everybody's got this mentality that somehow that can't work now. That somehow that's got to wait till we die and go to heaven. And that's not how the Lord put it. It is a reality of a covenant that we get to live out in a relationship with the Lord where we walk this thing out every day with Him. But you're going to have to begin to believe the elements of the covenant. And when we tonight we're going to have communion. And this communion, literally, we use this word communion and we're stuck in this idea of a sacrament. But literally, it means fellowship. We're going to take the tokens of the fellowship and we're going to do something. And I mean, I got hit with it on Sunday night. The Lord says, as often as you do this, you do in remembrance of me and you show forth my death till I come. And I got struck with this, like, download. You know, I'm standing there going, ooh, wow. Father, this is amazing, because in the midst of this communion, there is something about both your death and your coming that we're partaking of with an expectation. He's died, He's gone into heaven, but now He's coming again, and we're participating in something that we only know in part right now, but we're going to one day sit at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Tonight we're going to have the supper of the Lamb. You understand? This is the supper of the Lamb. Hallelujah. He says, He takes bread and He says, this is my body, which is broken for you. And we got to understand that He gave His life so that we might have His life. And in this understanding this deliverance that comes through the offering of the blood of the Lamb. Understand this fellowship that comes through the offering of the blood of the Lamb. And we see the deliverance that comes from the offering of the blood of the Lamb as we look at Israel being delivered out of Egypt, delivered from a people who had an iron grip upon them and would not let them go, who had absolute power and authority over them and oppressed them and afflicted them severely. They had no will, as it were, but God's power. And though there was great signs and great wonders and great demonstration of the power of God, insomuch that they experienced thick black darkness because God removed every bit of light from Egypt, that they would even gnaw their tongues for the pain. I mean, darkness that is on the level that it produces pain. You and I can't imagine that. We've had 2+ life. Okay, but there is a darkness that will create so much torment and so much agony and so much depression and so much pain that we can't even begin to imagine. And he did so many different great miracles to prove to them the severity of His judgment, trying to convince Him and nothing would work. But He brought forth a great deliverance by the offering of the blood and the sacrifice of the Lamb, which we know only pointed to Jesus, because Jesus took the Passover covenant, that remembrance that took place every year, and now He transitioned it over into now. This is the supper of the Lamb. This is now the supper of the new covenant. I'm going to show you this transition. And of course, we know that Jesus is our Passover Lamb. Paul used that same terminology describing who Jesus is. We know that He was actually sacrificed or crucified at the time of the offering of the Passover Lamb. I mean, all of the times, everything is fulfilled there. But we see when we're talking about communion and we recognize the power of the fellowship, God's trying to get something across to us. He's trying to help us understand the dimension of our total deliverance, that we've been brought out of everything that is profane and everything that is secular and everything that would torment us and everything that would try to rule over us and everything that would try to oppress us and everything that would try to separate us from our inheritance. We've been totally delivered out of that. So many people won't accept us in the communion. They just want to have something that basically solves the problem for the now, makes them feel better about their situation, kind of gives them a sense of it's okay right now, and now I'll come back later, you know, to make up for the difference and going to go back to my problems. You know, and not that it really changes, but that's not what this communion is about. This communion, every year, when you sit down and have Passover within the old covenant, you would rehearse. What does this mean? What is this? What are all of these things mean? What does this lamb mean? What does the wine mean? What does the bread of affliction mean? And you would relive the event of what brought the people of Israel into the covenant. so that you might rejoice in the covenant. And in all, and you know, there's so many things to say about this. Father says, I give you power to make wealth that my covenant may be established with you. He describes all of his blessings spiritually, physically, and materially centered around the covenant that was enjoined unto them. And now we understand a greater covenant has come. But we've got to find ourselves no longer living in the identity of our own person, but stepping into the reality of what the covenant that we're going to talk about once again and partake of in symbolism tonight really means. It means that we no longer live. We no longer have our life. He gave his life so that we might now live in him. And you're going to have to start thinking that way. You're thinking wrong. Those thoughts that think differently are your enemies, and you're going to have to learn how to kill them. Hello. Most people look at it and say, well, it's just too big for me. The giant's just too big. I'm going to hide here behind the rock. The giant's just too big. It's about time you see that God's far, far bigger. Yes. It's about time that you see that the one who's on your side is bigger than the one that is on their side. That the number of people that is with you are greater than the number of people that are with them. I mean, it's about time you start believing the new covenant. Amen. Paul said it like this. He said it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He said, if one died for all, then all are dead. Then we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. Why do you continue to live unto yourself? Because you measure your problems, you listen to satanic accusation. Many people actually participate with satanic accusation by accusing other people, thus giving Satan more power over them. Don't do that. Many people condemn other folks, thus giving Satan more power to condemn them. People slander other folks, thus giving Satan more power to slander them. There's no headway there, dear people. You are just afflicting and cursing and tormenting yourself. Quit cursing yourself with your own words. Quit cursing yourself with these things that you allow to dominate your thoughts. Learn how to shut down thinking that is wrong. I'm telling you, that's going to take you some supernatural power. God gives us power and ability to ultimately be able to govern and rule every thought that comes into our mind, decide what we're thinking about, what we're not going to think about. And nobody on the planet, no one has the power to do that. I need to get with some you know, PhD, MD, psychiatrist and people that are involved in psychological medicine, help them understand this so they can write some books on it. On measuring who can control their thoughts. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, the only people that even have the ability to decide what's going to be entertained in their mind are the people who are being ruled by the Holy Ghost and being ruled by the Word. Everybody else is overrun with all kinds of torments and affliction. Everything is negative and bad. It's coming down. It's crashing down. They're going to die. Everything around them is going to die. They're going to perish. They're going to be bankrupt tomorrow. I mean, the whole end of the world's coming in the next 24 hours. You hear what I'm saying? I mean, some people are just, a lot of people, most people are so negative. As soon as they hear any report, as soon as the phone rings, there's trouble. Rather than it's, hey, you know, it's a call, somebody's telling me I've just got the blessing, it's someone's going to, it's a curse. Huh? It's just always expecting to send some kind of a downfall, some kind of a defeat, some kind of a failure. Huh? Right? Are you listening to me? Abel, wouldn't it be wonderful if all of a sudden you were ruled by the Word of God? You learn how to live by the Word of God. Hallelujah. You just said you invalidated everything that was not the Word of God. See, I invalidate problems. I don't have any. They're invalid. They don't count. I categorically place them in a group called lies. Because I've got the solution. I live in the solution. I don't live my own life. So in reality, it's not even my problem. It's Jesus' problem because I'm in him. That is the covenant. That's the communion. That's the fellowship. I now live by him. Jesus used various ways to describe this when he said, eat my flesh and drink my blood. He used other ways to describe it. He says, I am the vine, you the branch. You must abide in me. Without me, you can do nothing. Ultimately, you're going to have to be willing to embrace what God has commanded over you, what God has prophesied over you, what God has declared about you, and boldly say, for me to live is Christ. Because everybody is waiting to someday be able to say that. Someday I want to be able to say. Someday will never come. Someday, somewhere over the rainbow, it just ain't going to come. unless it's a gift and it's been brought to you by the Word of God, and you receive it for what it is, it will never happen. The someday, God isn't a God of someday. He's not a God of tomorrow. You can have this. Maybe sometime in the future if you pass the test. He's the God of the now. Today is the day of His salvation. Amen. It's something He gives to us that we don't earn. See, it's just too big. It's just too big. This is too big for me to have this as a free gift. Hey, man, you're good to go. You are born into this. You are born with more than a silver spoon in your mouth. It's like the very wealthy kid who comes from a family who's been generating wealth since the 10th century, and there are those families today. There are families that's old money that have been, generating wealth for the past over 1,000 years, and they're well-to-do. And the kid's, born in this and goes, I don't deserve these billions of dollars. I don't deserve the Maserati. I don't deserve the Bentleys. I don't deserve all of these servants. But whether you deserve it or not, you're born into it. This is what you get. Hello. I hope that you get born into all the riches of God. I hope you get born into all the spiritual blessing. I hope you get born into all the provision. I hope you get born into all the protection. I hope you get born into all of the wonderful supply of heaven.
Amen.
I hope you get born into the perfection. I got tutors. I mean, God takes care of everything. I got a nose wiper, an ear wiper, a hair comber. I got everything. I do nothing for myself. God's taking care of me from stem to stern. Are you listening to me? Don't look at me like that. I got dressers. I mean, I'm telling you right now, clothes makers. I mean, I don't have to do nothing. I just walk around in this royal state of God's goodness and provision.
Amen.
Don't look at me like I'm singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Don't look at me like I'm telling you a fairy tale. I'm describing to you in very simple terminology these things that God has declared to us with great displays of His love and grandiose words of divine glory and power. Come on. Heirs of God? Heir, I'm a God's heir. Give me a break. I mean, co-inheritors with Jesus Christ, who He is right now, head of over all principality and power, might, dominion, every name that is named. Has all authority in heaven and earth, and you and I are seated together with Him. God never, it's just this beautiful thing in the new covenant. He never exalts Jesus into a place without bringing us there together with Him.
Amen.
He never puts Jesus in this glorious realm without including us.
Yep, that's right.
Does anybody deserve that? Absolutely not. And if you ever did, you can't have it. Because it would be a deception, because you can never be that on your own. God gives us a gift. He gives us a gift of a new birth. He gives us the gift of being born into the family of God. He gives us the gift of inheritance. He gives us the gift of righteousness and holiness. He gives us the gift of the greatest tutor that has ever existed, the Holy Ghost. Them in the old covenant, they just had to really put in the hands of angels. Me, I'm putting the hands of the Holy Ghost. He's taking good care of me. My goodness, laid everything out there. I'm telling you, my goodness, there's no servant like God. Hard to understand, isn't it? At the marriage supper of the Lamb, He will cause us all to sit down. Even the people that are so busy at work, who's always serving everybody, like my wife, who just hardly lets anybody serve with her. He's going to say, everybody sit down, including Ann, sit down. And He's going to take the servant's towel, and he's going to wait on every one of us and serve us this wonderful communion, this wonderful meal. Hallelujah. This marriage supper of the Lamb, this that communion, that peace offering, that salamim. See, that was another dimension of what the blood covenant and the sacrifice of the Lamb would be all about. Because everywhere you look at the sacrificial system in the Old Testament, all it was declaring by a typology the coming of the Redeemer, Christ Jesus. And so at the opening book of what we call Leviticus, for example, in the Hebrew language, Leviticus isn't Leviticus. The Hebrew word is Vayekra. And Vayekra means, and He called. Because usually in the Hebrew Bible, the way Hebrew books are named is the first word of that book. And so the first word of what we call Leviticus is Vayekra. And Vayekra means, and He called. Okay? And He called Elohim. Vayekra Elohim. And God called, and He said, if anyone wants to come near to me, karev, if anyone wants to come near to me, And that means to the karav, or the kariv word, which is also has with it korban, the gift, and korah, which is refers to the priesthood. If anybody wants to get as near to me as he possibly can, let him bring the offering. Let him bring the blood and the lamb. Let him bring the offering and come to the door and stand here at the door.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The door of the holies of holies, the door of the tabernacle. Hallelujah. And we know who the door is. All these things, speaking of symbolism, are symbolisms and types declaring to us Christ Jesus, who is the door. No man comes to the Father except by me. He says, I am the door to the sheep. I am the gateway. I'm the entryway. I'm the one that, here's how you come. You know, and we think about, for example, we think about how that Paul just takes it and he describes all the elements of the communion. I want to read this. All the elements of the communion here. And remind me if I forget. I won't forget it though, because I want to talk to you more about the evidence of the covenant, what the new covenant would bring. So open up to Hebrews chapter 10, put your finger on it, and let me talk to you a little bit about the evidence of what the covenant would bring. Because Jeremiah said in Jeremiah chapter 31, hold your finger on Hebrews 10. I know this is the way I got to do it, okay? Because I'm weaving a bunch of thoughts together for you. See, the Bible is one word, Jesus. Hallelujah. And it's, you know, it's a lot of words to say one word, Jesus. Jesus said, I come in the volume of the book. Behold, it's written of me to thy will. The whole volume of the book, Jesus is it. He's it. Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. It's all about Jesus. Hallelujah. Makira, the word, the living word. Amen. And see, I know the living word because he lives in me. I know the word, the living word intimately. He gave me his flesh to eat. His body is meat indeed. His body, in other words, his sacrifice at the cross is the means of my life. What do we do with food? What will food do for us? Sustain our life. Without food, are you going to live? Not long. Huh? And his blood is drink indeed. What is drink going to do? Sustain your life. Are you going to live very, very long without drink? No. You're going to live a shorter period of time without drink than you are going to be without food. He's the very, so even as food and drink is as the very sustaining life of the body, so that which Jesus Christ supplied for us at the cross is the very sustaining life of our whole being forever, including our spirit, soul, and body. Because my body's sitting so full of the Holy Ghost right now that I'm going to raise up from the dead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am at the last trump. My body's coming out. I'm going to responding to the voice of God. Let me just tell you something that hit me today. Can I tell you something that hit me today? And I'll get back to this. Because I can't, you know, this is the way I do it. And this is the way God does it through me, praise God. But I was reading today, you know, and there's been so many wonderful things said about that verse of scripture in Exodus chapter 3, where the Lord says to Abraham, I am, which is translated, I am which I am, or I am who I am, or I am that I am. It's the same way. It's a very direct translation in the Hebrew language. It's also, if you look in the Septuagint, which is the Greek Old Testament, it's a very direct translation of the Greek and the Septuagint as well. But I begin to think about what ikoimi means. Ikoimi, which is I am, it literally means it's me. So if I'm translating in very common, you know, vernacular, Greek vernacular language for the common man, which we call Koine Greek, I just say, it's me. And when you use the doublet in either Hebrew language or the doublet, the doubling of words in the Greek language, it expresses intensity. So it's literally, it's really me. And I was thinking today, here's Abraham standing there going, who should I say is sending me? And God saying, hey, it's me. It's really me. It's me. It's me. As though every man knows the voice of God. Wow. That it's like Father taking up from Adam, you know. Adam, where are you? Adam, where are you? And then the very makeup of the being of men came forth from the voice of God. The very makeup of the being of men was shaped by his hands, and he breathed into our life, into our nostrils, the breath of life, so that really, by nature, we know who he is. Deep inside, our whole being exists by him. Our very breath came from him. It's a reproduction of his breath. It's God that he gave me that breath. It belongs to him. It's God's breath. And it's like he's standing there. And, you know, though Moses is a number of generations removed from Adam, it's like he's looking into Moses' eyes and seeing Adam and going, hey, it's me. Go tell him that, hey, it's me sent you. It's really me. And of course, we know in verse 16 of Genesis chapter 3, he goes on to say who he is. I am Yehovah God. He identifies himself very specifically. I am Yehovah God, the God of your fathers, Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. But I mean, the beautiful intimacy of it, the fellowship of it, the knowing the voice of God. It's not that hard to hear the voice of God. Everybody knows deep on the inside that God is God. That's why there is no agnostics or atheists in any foxhole anywhere. They're all going, ah, God, forget me. Help me. They're all crying out to God. Is this true? Get men. I don't care who they are. I don't care how uppity they think they are. Because they got everything going their way, and they go to the grocery store and the gas station, they got all the stuff and the conveniences of life, you know, and they can be super brave and confident in themselves. Strip them down naked, set them out in the woods to survive on their own, and they're going to be crying out to God inside of a couple of days. Yet that long. Are you listening to me? There's no grocery store. There's no lawyer. There's no doctor. There's no policeman. There's no 911. There's no hospital. You digging for roots now because you don't even know how to fire a gun. Or pull an arrow through a bow. Or throw a knife. Or throw a spear. What do you think that person's going to do? I mean, it's just going to be a pathetic thing if everything got, you know, the lights got turned off around here. Because people have been just so, they have been trained to do nothing. They have no real life skills. You know what I'm saying? Typewriters, computers, telephones, cars won't work in this situation. Are you listening to me? Can you hear the overtones of what I'm trying to talk to you about here? Good. Everybody knows in the inner depths of their being who God is. They know that He's there. And the beautiful thing about it is the Holy Ghost now has been poured out upon all flesh, and He's crying out to men. Everywhere He's crying out to us. And and you and I have responded, and we should be responding fully and just saying, wait a minute. Why half measures? Why just sit out here on the outer portion of the court, looking way off in the distance, seeing the glory of God, longing to be there one day? Why not just come, as Paul says right here? Why not just come on over here? He says right here in Hebrews chapter 10, why don't you just step on into the holies of holies and live there? Before I get to that point, let me just talk a little bit about Jeremiah 31. And hear what Jeremiah said, 31:31. Listen to what he says concerning the covenant. Jesus said, In once again, I remind you, in Matthew chapter 26, in verse 26, he said, this is the new covenant, 28, Matthew 26:28, my concordance reference is now hit me with a flash. In Matthew 26:28, Jesus said, this is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you to erase and remit sin. I want you to understand the full impact of that here tonight. I want you to understand the full impact of that is that you're a new creation. You're a new creature. I want you to understand the full impact of what Jeremiah said. God is going to bring forth a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah after those days, saith God. What does he tell us? He tells us that he's going to write his laws in our heart and in our mind. He tells us by the prophet Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 36 and 26. He said, this is the new covenant that I will give with you. He said, I will take away the heart of flesh, and I will take away the heart of stone, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. I'll circumcise your heart. He says, I'll give you a new heart, and I'll give you a new spirit, and I'll put my spirit in you. This is what Jesus is saying. When he says, this is the new covenant in my blood, he's telling us this is the means now by which you receive a new heart. This is the means by which you receive a new spirit. This is the means by which you receive my Holy Spirit. This is the means by which I write my laws in your heart and in your mind so that you will keep them. In other words, you talk about God putting his word on the inside of us. You talk about thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. You talk about I write unto you young men because the word of God abides in you and you're strong. He says, I put my word in you so that you can live my word, so that you can speak my word, so that you can declare my word, so that you ultimately can live my word. If you're not speaking his word, if you're not thinking his word, you're not going to live his word. The enemy is constantly trying to sow seeds of doubt and unbelief and separation and condemnation and guilt and shame, all things which would try to separate us and make us a long distance away from God, somehow trying to earn His love, uncertain about His love. But when you'll just come and begin to be equipped with His Word, then you can come to understand how to know and believe the love that God has for you. Because if you'll just live in this, then you're going to live in all of His glory. To know and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. That's who He is. What is the poured out blood? What does the broken body of Jesus represent? It represents this amazing love of God for us. That He would do this for us. That this is the means by which He produces the new covenant. This is the means by which we now clean escape from the tyranny of Satan. And we've been delivered out of death. And we've been delivered out of bondage. And we've been delivered out of the curse. It is the means by which we now get to draw near unto Him. It's the means by which we now get to live as a new creation. Here's what the Lord says. He says concerning the new covenant. He says, nothing will produce any favor or additional regard. And I'm just using some easy words to understand here. All that matters to me, I don't care about circumcision. I don't care about uncircumcision. I don't care about your genealogy. I don't care about who your parents were. I don't care about what tribe you come from. All that matters to me is whether or not you've been made a new creation, is what Paul says. That it would be found in Galatians chapter 6 and probably somewhere around verse 14 or 15. We could look that up later, okay? We can come back to that because he says that a number. That's all that matters. That's all that counts for anything with God. How did the new creation come? It came to us by way of the new covenant. Jesus said, this is the new covenant. Here's how it's going to happen. Here is the means by which it is going to be established. No covenant is established without the shedding of blood. There has to be the invocation of blood. The blood has to be poured out to be able to step in to make the covenant living. Now Jesus takes it to another level. Because now it's not like the covenant that God made with Abraham when he passed through the sacrifice and the pieces that were divided there before the Lord. And he saw Father in the midst of the fire and the glory. It's not like the covenant that God established with Israel as he made known his ways and his law to Moses there on Mount Sinai, when Moses was able to see the fullness of the divine power and glory of God, and Father with his own finger wrote in tablets of stone those things which men were commanded to do so that he might dwell in the midst of them. As Moses beheld this glory that caused his own face to shine with a similar type of glory, which we would actually even refer to as a lethal glory that nobody could look at. He had put a veil over his face. Because he had light up, especially, I mean, by tradition, it's believed that as soon as he got near the temple, he would start radiating with such glory that it was a blinding glory, like looking at the sun. Now, that's just tradition. But nonetheless, we do know he had to veil himself. Whether he walked around, the issue is whether he had to walk around with the veil all the time or not. And supposedly, by tradition, this is Talmudic tradition, this is a tradition of the Hebrews. He would veil himself when he got close to the temple because he'd start, as soon as he got close to God, he'd start radiating the same brightness of God. Having once encountered that glory, whatever glory you encountered in God is the glory that you can make manifest through your life. Hallelujah. Listen to me tonight. And Father, listen, His glory is holy and it's sacred. And though it's all a free gift, it's still sacred. And there's going to have to be something that goes on in our life so that we can begin to touch the sacred in deeper ways. And that is a hunger and a thirsting, a longing for it, a desire to have it above all other things. And we can say with our mouth all we want, oh, God, I hunger for it, I want it. But constantly, we're choosing things above God if we're not careful. Huh? We're simply, you know, Jesus says, one of you going to betray me? And everybody's going, is it I? And he could have said, yes. Because every one of them did. It just one of them actually handed him over. And even Judas said, is it me? And he knew. He already sold Jesus. You know what he sold Jesus for? He sold Jesus for the price of your lowest, cheapest slave. The slave you got on bargain day. You know, this is the idiot slave who can't do anything but bring you the hammer kind of thing. No, it's true. I'm telling you right now. you know, slurs against any particular slaves out there. I just tried to express to you the reality of this. They said that was a slave, cost of a slave, the lowest kind of slave, cheapest slave you could buy, 30 pieces of silver. That's the value that he valued him at. That is whacked out, man. I mean, Judas is watching him. Judas watched him turn the water into wine. Judas watched him walk on the water. Judas watched him raise the dead. Judas watched all these beautiful things. He watched a few loaves and a few fishes. He watched and saw and beheld his glory. He knew the value and the worth of Jesus. And he sold him for 30 pieces of silver. However, I've seen in my own life where I've almost sold him for cheaper. How about you? Yeah. Sold him out for something cheaper. Yes. Something of less value. Come on now, people. Watch out now. Come on. Understand, we just can't be so flippant about this great grace that has been given to us. Hey, listen, it may be free, but it's not cheap. It costs a lot. It bankrupted heaven. I mean, God took all of his wealth and all of his riches, and he laid it out there in Christ Jesus for you and me. And Jesus took all of his wealth and all of his riches, and he laid it out there at Calvary so that you and I could ultimately step into the covenant, to now begin to live the covenant, recognize that we no longer live. We've been bought with a price. We're not our own. What price did he value us with? 30 pieces of silver? No. The price of his own blood. The price of his own life. How valuable is that? What worth have you placed upon that? I pray that you understand the fellowship for which this symbol represents, which we go in deeper with, really beyond just the eating of the table. I mean, I'm thinking tonight, when I take this bread, I'm thinking about, I'm going to sit down at the marriage supper of the Lamb. I'm going to be eating something far more grand than all of this. I'd like to make the supper bigger. I don't really know how to yet. I don't know anybody who really knows how to make good loaves of unleavened bread, you know, like Mama Sarah, like Emmy Sarah. You know what I'm saying? Like a good Jewish mama, huh? I don't know anybody who knows how to do that, because that'd be great. Fresh, unleavened loaves, cut off a slice, pass it around, hey? Big, giant cup, everybody drinking out, slurping out of the same thing. Most people go, no, germs don't eat. What is germs, man? What is bacteria? What is viruses, huh? We've got all this, you know, these various theories within the framework of microbiology and virology, bankrupt by and large. There's far more to it than what men have discovered. And once again, there'll be another edition next year. Yeah. And one after that. Eventually, men would come to the truth, but we don't have enough time for that. It's time to step into the truth right now. It's been given to us. Hallelujah. It's been handed to us on more than a silver plate. It's been handed to us in the midst of the glory of God. And people say, well, I don't have time for the word. You serious trouble.
Yes, that's true.
You have valued yourself and valued God in the wrong way. You don't understand the word that is spirit and life. You don't understand the living word that is expressed by the written word, but we want you to. God wants you to. You don't have to feel bad about yourself tonight. You can just recognize that you've been stupid. And you don't want to be stupid anymore. Huh? Life is hard. It's harder for those who are stupid. You know what I'm saying? The Lord's made life easy for everybody to come and learn of Him. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come get some lowliness and meekness. Come live by the Word. Come live by the Spirit. Suddenly start valuing your time. You know, people, I run into people that get older. You know, I run into people successful, lawyers, successful, you know, scientists, PhDs, doctors, others who come to know the Lord. And all of a sudden, money isn't so important to them anymore. You know why? Because they're about 60. And then what happens to you when you get about 60? You begin to start thinking more seriously about the fact you're getting ready to die. Before you're just, yeah, you know, you're numb and you're thinker. You're just blindly running through life as though you're never going to die. So you're never going to give an account. Suddenly, it starts happening. I'm going to die. Am I ready? What is the real value of my time? What is the meaning? What value do I place on my day? Some people say, well, I'm worth $300 an hour. Some people say, well, I'm worth $30 an hour. Poor guy. You know what I say it? Hey, you know what? Being worth $30 an hour is better than being worth $3 an hour. You know what I'm saying? There's some people that work for $3 an hour. Are you listening to me? Is everybody hearing me over here?
Yes.
You know, come on. What do you value your hours to be? Do you value your hours that is worth something of eternity? Can you value your hours based on the eternity, your eternity? Can you value your hours based upon the worth by which He has valued you and your life? When you think about the framework of eternity, and you now normalize it, okay, with me, for all you math people, normalize it against the total number of days that we have here in this life. Whoo, is a day worth a lot? Can you hear me? Normalize it. Normalize the total number of days that we have in this life with eternity. And now your days, your hours, your seconds are of great value. And in reality, our seconds, our minutes, our hours, our days determine the place that we have eternity, heaven or hell. With Him, with God, or without God, in a place of His glory, or a place in the shame of darkness, because we chose, brother, to follow a demonic realm and be held in the prison. Because many people are like this. God has delivered them and said, "Now, you guys go on, I'm staying here in Egypt. They need a brick maker. I feel more comfortable making bricks than going out there with you guys. No telling what you're going to face out there. A bird in a hand is better than two in a bush." I got three meals and I got two, I don't know. I got one meal and a place to sleep, you know. I got one meal and a rock bed. I'm staying with this. You guys go out there. You guys, nothing out there. And I heard that the Hittites occupied the land of our inheritance, and that the Jebusites were there, and the descendants of Og are there. You ain't going to get it. Even if you got there, they're going to kill all of you. I'm going to stay here because I got protection from Pharaoh in my life. That's what I value my life to be. What do you value your life? What do we value our life? When we begin to eat and drink of the fellowship that we have, that we've been given in the new covenant, we're going to have to understand the value of our life, because we understand that that's how we were purchased. We were bought with this price. Hallelujah. It's not the bread of affliction anymore. It's the bread of deliverance. Hallelujah. And I want to show you that. Hallelujah. I want to show you tonight what the broken bread is. Look with me in Hebrews chapter 10. I want you to get this so you can preach it. First of all, I want you to get this so you can preach it. Understand it. Somebody said, "Oh, you got to practice before you preach." Well, you preach before you practice. You understand me? Because a confession is first before the living reality. You need to start prophesying over yourself good things instead of cursing yourself. Somebody said, "I think somebody down in Tijuana, some witch doctor is cursing me." You don't need no witch doctor from Tijuana to curse you. Many people doing a good job on their own. Talking bad about themselves, running themselves up and down, how God don't like them, how all they messed up, and how they're never going to be worthy, and how it's never going to work out, and how it's just one problem after another, and oh, poor old me. You don't need no witch doctor from Tijuana. You did far more than that witch doctor could ever done to you. Come on. Give me a break. You're going to have to start preaching the word. I want you to start preaching the word. I want you to start standing up and saying, "I'm in Jesus and He's in me. For me to live as Christ, I no longer live. I had communion." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I had communion. I had communion on the level of fellowship, being born again, born of the Word, born of the Spirit. You're born of an incorruptible seed by the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. You must be born of the Spirit. Otherwise, you can't come into the kingdom of God, because that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And I've been born of the Spirit. And as many as are sons of God that have been born of the Spirit are living in the Spirit. I'm living in the Spirit. You have to quit living your own life, knowing yourself after what, you know, somebody described to you up until the point that you were introduced to God. He told you who you were when you stepped into the family. I don't care who you were before you came into the family. You're something different now. Amen. And it's the only way you're going to understand who you are now that you're in the family is to read the book. Amen. Amen. And hear what God has to say, because He's speaking right now. God, who in times past spoke unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by His Son, whom He has appointed heir of all things, by whom He also made the worlds. Amen. Amen. Isn't that beautiful? He's talking. He's talking. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you right now, you begin to give yourself to the Word. I had an idea today. I thought, "Well, Lord, could I put this on everybody? I'd love to be able to put this on everybody, probably more than they could bear, but it'd be good for them. I think that everybody should type out their own Bible. Just take whatever, take King James, whatever, just remove all the these and the thous. That would be your assignment. Just take the simple things and from English that you would know would make it, smooth it out. Don't change any words. Just smooth it out so it's not these and thous and thithers and withers. You know how to say it? Huh? Because I guarantee you get finished typing it out, something's going to be happening to you. Huh? Yeah, you can read it in 90 days, but you can't type it out in 90 days, I guarantee you. But your life would be changed. It wouldn't take you long. Praise God. You become intimately acquainted with the Word of God. And then the Holy Ghost will be able to bring into your remembrance all these things. Huh? Let me just, I know you're holding your finger on Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to get to Hebrews chapter 10. It's coming up real quickly. It's hot in the oven. It's still baking. It's still baking a little bit. It's got a little bake a little bit more. I'm just checking on it. It ain't browned up yet. So back, go look with me, Hebrews chapter 8. I want to just kind of look at, I want you to see this summary here. A couple of verses of scripture in Hebrews chapter 8. And the Lord says this, and it says, I want you to, I could read these to you out of the Old Testament, but it has more impact for me to read them out of the New Testament. And that way you know that Paul knew what he was talking about when he applied these verses of scripture to the New Covenant, because it is New Covenant. This is the New Covenant that Jesus was talking about in Matthew chapter 26, 28. And he says this, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. Somebody said, well, I'm not of the house of Israel. No, but you are beneficiary. Hallelujah. Because Jesus said, I'm only sent to the lost sheep of Israel. Hallelujah. And he first brought that covenant and the opportunity to the house of Israel. And then out of the house of Israel, he raised up a people anointed of the Holy Ghost to go to all the nations. I'm going to tell you right now, on the day of Pentecost, there was not one single Gentile or people of other nations there. It was all those of the house of Israel. That day, this scripture was fulfilled. A new covenant was fully revealed as the Holy Ghost and fire was poured out upon approximately 120 people, for which we get to continually enjoy. And I hope you get into Pentecost and you want the fire of the Holy Ghost, yes, and you want the moving, yes, of the Spirit, yes, and you allow praise to fill up your life that the Holy Ghost brings on a continual basis. Because if you will, instead of getting off into all the other stuff that is worldly and earthly, it will become strong and built up in your life, and you'll find yourself increasing with increasing, yes, God, because you'll find a connection that's going on in a fellowship that will then produce a continuous supply out of heaven more than you can contain. Amen. This is what Pop Man is for. This is a good life. Yes. This is money life. I hope I can. I'm a good commercial advertisement for the Lord tonight. That's what I am. I'm a produce, I'm a produce sign saying the fruit is good. Eat it. That's all I am. Just proclaiming these things. It's up to you whether or not you're going to come and enjoy the goodness of these benefits, whether you're going to believe these things and begin to apply them and no longer speak this thing after the manner of speech from which you've learned from men. Begin to speak those things which you have learned from your Father which is in heaven, which those things which the Spirit of the Lord would teach you, so that your tongue would become as the pen of a ready writer, ready to proclaim those things which the Spirit of the Lord is saying. But this is what God is doing. This is what He wants to do in your life. It is up to you. Each man chooses on a daily basis. And Father is long-suffering, not willing that any perish. He continues to deal with us. And many people are hard to hear, and they're slow to respond. But yet God, in His mercy and His love, He continues to reach out to us. He continues to call to us. He continues to preach the same sermon over and over and over again. I've had many people come to me and go, my goodness, I didn't realize it was this easy. It was this glorious. It's this wonderful. This is what you're talking about, isn't it? Yeah, uh-huh. Sorry, it took you 20 years. I mean, come on. But 20 years is better. 20 years is better than not at all. You know what I'm saying? 20 years is better than 40 years to get it, right? But how about getting it in 3 years? How about touche baranatea? How about getting it in the first 3 minutes?
Yes.
I'm telling you right now, Cornelius' house was superior to the 12 apostles. It took them more than 3 years to get it. Cornelius got it in 5 minutes, him and his whole house. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You couldn't tell them they're not to be baptized in the Holy Ghost at the moment that they got saved. And you know what? I'll just tell you something real quickly. Peter didn't even make no altar call. Are you listening to me? He was just telling them about Jesus. He was a reluctant preacher. He showed up and said, I don't even know why I'm here. I'm going to get in trouble for even being here. You guys are unclean. I'm clean. I'm going to get contaminated by being around you. Now, the reason I'm here is because the angel of the Lord appeared unto me and said, call nothing common or unclean that I have made clean. and revealed to me that I was supposed to come to you, that there was, you had sent some of your servants down. They were waiting for me down at the entry of the house, and I was to go with them asking no questions. That's usually how God wants us to move with them anyways. Come with me, do what I'm telling you, ask no questions. You're going to have to get over all your question asking. Say nothing. Get this, so he gets there and he says, okay, why am I here? Cornelius says, well, an angel appeared to me and said that you're the one who had the words of life. Preach to us. And so he begins to talk about Jesus. He began to talk about how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Amen. For God was with him. See, that's central to the gospel. That's the gospel that Jesus preached. People want to have another gospel. They want to have a gospel that teaches all kinds of different things, but I want to have the gospel that Jesus preached. All right, we understand how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost of power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed with the devil, for God was with him. That's Acts 10:38. He's standing there preaching to them, declaring them the good things of God. And he barely got through. Hardly a sermon would take, you know, just a few minutes to preach. And suddenly, the power of the Holy Ghost came upon all of them. He didn't have an altar call. He said, how many of you want to give your life to Jesus? He didn't know it was available. He didn't even know it was available. He didn't even know. Yeah, at Jerusalem, the great council of Jerusalem, the great mighty men of great wisdom and insight full of the Holy Ghost didn't even know. They didn't even know. It had not been yet revealed to them that the Gentiles also could be made partakers of the same Holy Ghost in the same dimension and degree of salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am so earnest to see the movings of God in the church today as it was then. Yes. I'm so interested in seeing the heart so stirred towards God. I mean, I tell you right now, dear people, you have not for you ask not. Yes. Begin to ask God for souls and see what will happen. Yes. Begin to ask God to use you in such a way where Holy Ghost conviction and power can flow through your life. But I'm going to tell you something. Before Holy Ghost conviction power can flow through your life and cause men to become overwhelmed with the consciousness of their need for God and a desperate sense and understanding of their sinful condition, you yourself are going to have to respond to Holy Ghost conviction. Amen. You're going to have to learn how to respond to the gentle, small, because to a relationship, for those who are in relationship with the Lord, He comes to them with a still, small voice. He doesn't come. There was a great wind that came and rent the rocks and exploded them. And after that, there was a great fire. And after that, a great earthquake. But God was not in the wind. And God was not in the fire. And God was not in the earthquake. Then a still, small voice. And you know what He said? Elijah, what are you doing here? He's like, Elijah, what are you doing? Hallelujah. A still small voice, it's me. And Elijah wraps his, as soon as the still small voice, Elijah wraps his face in his mantle. Have you ever experienced God like that? I have. I've experienced God where you're so overwhelmed with that glory and that goodness. And I'm hungry for more. All those encounters with God do is make you more hungry, make you more dissatisfied. It just makes you more dissatisfied with all the things that this earth has to offer. It makes you more dissatisfied with the way that you function. Because all you can see is the riches before you and the call of God upon you. The spiritual riches that we're blessed with. We're blessed with all spiritual blessings. All the spiritual riches in Christ Jesus are ours. He who was rich became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. And we're not talking about just monetizing it. Although God is concerned about every dimension of your life, and the inheritance impacts every dimension of your life. Not just spiritual, not just physical, but also materially, financially. But we pray that you wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers, or in direct proportion to your soul prosperity. We don't want anything else to outdo or outrun the spiritual prosperity, because as long as your spiritual prosperity is continually increasing, all the rest of the stuff won't really even matter that much. Because all that really matters, the apple of your eye is Jesus. The desire of your heart is heaven. Yes. All the things that you want more than anything else is to please the Father, to do the Father's will. You don't have to think this through, work it through. All you got to get down on your face and say, thank you, God. All you got to do is take the blood and the bread. All you got to do is lift your hands and worship. If you sit there and think, how am I going to do it? How am I going to work it out? How am I going to strategize? Ain't nothing ever going to happen, because you're in the wrong realm. Don't work in that realm. It don't work in that realm. There are no answers in that realm. You will not discover in your little, puzzled brain how to put all the pieces together and make it work. You're going to have to learn how to hear the voice of God and just step out and obey. It's all walking on the water, people. Listen to me. All salvation is walking on the water. You know, that's a supernatural step by step. Hallelujah. It's all a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It's a rejoicing all day long in whatever situation you find yourself in. If you're in the middle of a job right now, you don't need to quit your job. You need to quit yourself and start worshiping God and be an example and a glorious, you know, presence, a sweet aroma in the house and in the place. Hallelujah. You need to quit worrying. I mean, I'm telling you, I was so blessed. Brittany was just sharing with me. You know, she just touched with the fire of God the other day and a couple weeks back, and she was walking around in the, and you know, doing her thing as a waitress, and somebody said, "Man, I see a fire on the inside of you." And she said, she figured that, you know, just thinking, well, they must know what they're talking about. They used the word fire. She said, "Well, just guess what it is." And the person started guessing all these wrong guesses, you know, Buddha, Krishna, whatever, you know. And she's wrong. That's the power of the Holy Ghost, says Jesus in me. Hey, you know what I mean? Listen, you could walk around like this. If you get out of your problem, well, I'm just a loser. Got to go to work. Never going to amount to much. And wish I was in Jesus. Wish he was in me. I had a communion and lost it. Had one move of God one time. It was the greatest thing that ever happened. I can't ever get it back. Whatever it is that people do. I don't know what people do. I don't even want to know what people do. I just know they're doing something wrong. I'm just trying to encourage you. Come, just do it right. It's not like it's hard, you know. It's not like it's hard. I mean, I was riding with Chris yesterday, and you know, he's in his special program at USD for people that are brilliant, that are doing mathematical equations that are just crazy. I mean, it's just stuff that you just, you know, the frequency, the special, you know, harmonic frequencies of two molecules meeting somewhere in space. Awesome. You know what I'm saying? No. To create structure. Well, you just talked to Chris about it back there. You know what I'm saying? And there's like, you know, there's seven people in the graduate program kind of thing, you know? If you had to do that to get into the Holy Ghost, I'd feel sorry for you and I'd understand your problem. If you had to do that kind of stuff, I mean, where you spend 2 days on a single problem without any sleep, kind of thing, I can understand why you're miserable. But we're not talking about having to do that.
Thank you, Lord.
We're talking about eating my flesh. We're talking about eating my flesh and drink my blood. Come on. Yeah. We're talking about freely you have received. We're talking about freely you, freely. Hey, if God spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, how shall he not much more but give to us all things freely by him? Hey, somebody didn't know. Somebody said, well, did you? It was an exciting thing he said. That was actually something that God said by Paul, Romans 8:32. That's the word of God. Hallelujah. I just pray that you come and just understand how you can live your life by the word, how you can process every event in your life by the word of God. How when you begin to face something, you think it through the word of God. Somebody the other day, and I don't know whether they're trying to insult me or compliment me, but they said, my goodness, you don't even have your own opinion. You just process everything by the word.
Praise God.
Then I'm like, thank you. This is my desire. That's what I want, and I do. I automatically do. I process things based on the word of God. And I process it based on, oh, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Hallelujah. I process it on the basis of those things which he set forth in his word so we can discern between good and evil, right and wrong. We know what is of God and what is of men, what's of Satan. When you live in an unlimited realm, you don't have to think too much about it. Just do it. Huh? When you live in an unlimited realm where God's favor is upon you, he's going to give you the desires of your heart. Watch the desires. What's God put on the inside of you? What has God put big on the inside of you? When you were born of God, when you were born of the Spirit, what was big on the inside of you? God's going to give that to you.
Amen.
I got a list of things that are in my life that is a heavenly vision. It's all around the heavenly vision. That's what's big on the inside of me. Somebody said, I don't have anything big on the inside of me. Get yourself something big on the inside of you.
Yes,
and let me tell you, You know, have you ever noticed if you read a book, you get inspired by it? Why don't you read the book? You'll get so inspired. I mean, my goodness, you know, you get a creative idea. Let me just tell you this. We learned this in science. You get a creative idea about something, start running down a theory, and then all you do is you just go into the literature and you start doing literature searches on that particular, you know, idea and subject matter. And as you read, the idea gets bigger and bigger, and the missing parts begin to fill in the place, and the structure of it and the concept of it and the theory of it becomes more exact and more focused and more accurate. So it is with the Word of God. People just, they perish for a lack of knowledge, a lack of the knowledge of God. They've just listened to so many preacher preaching sermons that are nothing more than Christian philosophy and Christian ideology and Christian traditions, and it's not the Word of God. Jesus said you've made void the Word of God by your traditions. Nothing's changed. Get yourself an idea in God. Hallelujah. And then it start letting it explode on the inside of you because you're eating that which is food. Yes. Indeed.
Yes.
See, Jesus is the true manna sent down from heaven. And he likened his body unto his word. Hallelujah. And when I eat his flesh tonight, I recognize, when I eat that which represents his body, I recognize I'm partaking of that wonderful, glorious provision that God utilized to transfer my sins from off of me. And remove them forever. Because the new covenant, he says, I will take away your sins. I will wash them all away. And I will remove them. Remove your iniquity. And I will remember them no more. Amen. I'm in agreement with God. Hallelujah. Yeah. People talk about, man, I was an idiot. I was a drug addict. I pumped my veins full of dope. You know, and this is supposed to be something that they're supposed to be given as a testimony. I used to get so drunk, I didn't know. I thought I was a chimpanzee. You know, I mean, it just goes on and on. Listen, man, don't even. That's a, you in the wrong club. You're not even supposed to be remembered. That stuff has been removed as far as the east is from the west. Who cares how big of an idiot you were, man? You got to be brain dead to do what you did. Why would you ever rejoice in being stupid? You know what I'm saying? Hello. Why don't you talk about what God has done for you and show some kind of wisdom and sensibility? Praise God. Hallelujah. I mean, if you made $1 trillion, you and the most brilliant person on the face of the earth, maybe you could talk about that or something, you know. And then how Jesus came and all that meant nothing. But being stupid and being proud of it, that is a special kind of dumb. You know what I'm saying? God delivered us from the stuff and he erased it to remember it no more. And we're going to have to start agreeing with God on every level. I hope a lot of people watch this particular YouTube. In Jesus' name. He said, this is the new covenant that I will make with you. Hallelujah. This is my covenant I make with the house of Israel, saith the Lord. Look at this. I want you to get this. I will put my laws into your mind. Hallelujah. Somebody walk around saying your mind's all messed up. Mine's doing well. I stepped in the new covenant. Right, looky here. Looky right over here. Hallelujah. Besides that, most of the time in the Hebrew language, you don't know whether the word for heart, lev, is to be translated mind or to be translated heart. And God gave you a new heart, and by measure, it could actually say God gave you a new mind. Somebody said, well, Mark, you had some special work, a second work of grace. The second work of grace now in modern-day Pentecostalism is to have your mind renewed. No, it's not a second work of grace. So I said, oh, it's just soulless. Your soul's still hanging out there in limbo. It's not in limbo. That's right. There's no wiggle room for the devil. You need to be 100% spirit, soul, and body belonging to God. And that's the communion you're having. God didn't say, look, I'm going to take care of two-thirds of you. Well, listen, people don't even give them that much. I'm going to take care of one-third of you. You take care of the other two-thirds. Is that a deal? I'm going to get your spirit for you. You take care of your soul and your body. Good. Fare thee well. That's ridiculous. He redeemed us with his own blood. This is a new covenant. Hallelujah. My body, he says, is his purchased possession. My body is his temple, therefore to glorify God in my body and my spirit. He gave me a new spirit and he gave me a new heart. Hallelujah. He wrote his laws. Look at here. His ways, his testament, which is the way he thinks. Come on now, look at here. His knowledge, look at it, read it. This is the new covenant. You're going to fellowship with it here tonight. It's about time God's people quit giving any place to the devil, beginning with their theology. Let those things which you believe about God, what God did and made you to be, only be determined based on what he said in his word. And away with your tradition, and away with your philosophy, and away with your ideology, and away with your debates, and away with your questionings. Just read the word of God and say, this is too wonderful. Oh, what an unspeakable gift. Oh, look at what great things God has done for me. Hey, listen, it's not any harder for you than it would be for Mary. And the angel says, listen, you're going to have a baby. How am I going to have a baby? I'm not known a man. Yep. God's going to be conceived on the inside of you. The Most High will overshadow you, and that holy thing that should be born of you should be called the Son of the Living God. My goodness, the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. Come on. Mary was brilliant. Mary was a woman of the Spirit. She said this, be it unto me according to thy word. Could you learn that one phrase? Yeah. I need to teach everybody this phrase. Be it unto me according to your word. Luke 1:38. Amen. Not lukewarm 38. Lukewarm. I'm trying to help you. Luke 1:38. Be it unto me. Listen to his word. He said, I put my laws in your mind and I've written them. It's done. Be it unto me according to your word. This is what I know about myself. Come on. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'll put my laws into your mind and write them in your hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. They shall not teach every man his neighbor. No, every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least unto the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. We got ourselves a covenant, people.
Yeah. Amen.
I'm telling you right now, a covenant speaks of God's unending faithfulness to his commitment to me and you. I mean, if you just grab this, you won't sorrow no more. You won't let your heart be troubled anymore. You won't be down and out anymore in the kingdom of God, which is far worse than being down and out in Beverly Hills. Down and out in the kingdom of God, just to be on the skid row in the glory land. Come on. Hello. I've never seen the movie. I just heard about it. It just sounded good. Some people are looking at me like, that's not a good movie. Maybe it's not. I don't know. But you're not a good movie if you're living that way. So this is a more important issue of whether or not you're good and you're doing what's right. Versus all the other stuff. Now I want you to turn finally to Hebrews 10. And I want to just pick this up just concerning the new covenant real quick, and then I'm going to talk a little bit more about the flesh and the flesh and the blood. He says to us, and I'm going to start at verse 15 in Hebrews 10. Wherefore, or whereof rather, you know, that's just a loan word, the Holy Ghost, who is a witness to us. For after that he said before, here's the Holy Ghost, in other words, witnessing to us who we are right now, but witnessing to us in the past when he spoke by the prophets, okay? This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. When Jesus said, this is the covenant in my blood, which is given to you for the remission of sin, this is what he's talking about. I will put my laws into their hearts and in their minds will I write them, and their sins and their iniquity will I remember no more. Now, where remission of these is, there's no more need for an offering for sin. Tonight, that's what we're sowing. When I take of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, when I take of the blood, what represents the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm saying my sin and iniquity is removed. I'm saying that mercy of God is upon me and has changed me completely, making me those who are begotten of Him, part of the family, belonging to the living God. Christ Jesus, my brother, God the Father, my Father. Jesus said, I'm going to my God and your God, my Father and your Father. Hallelujah. And this is the covenant that we want to be a part of, that we're taking hold of His love. We're taking hold of His riches. We're taking hold of this change. We're taking hold of all this glorious provision that has brought to us this position with Him, where we're seated with Him in a heavenly realm. You talk about priests and kings. You talk about being made, as it were, rulers together with Him. We're a place where we're judging angels is soon to come, a place of walking with Him and being trained by the Holy Ghost in all the ways of righteousness and holiness. We were born in righteousness and holiness, given the gift of righteousness and holiness, now to be trained to walk in righteousness and holiness, to grow and mature in all the ways of God, to be in every way in conduct and character like Him. That's the beauty of grace. That's what's going on here. People act like somehow we've been redeemed and we can just go ahead and live like the devil. My goodness, what kind of insight is that? And that's the first book of the devil, by second demon, you know, or whatever. You know, I don't know. It's just crazy. It's the Antichrist version. It's just ridiculous. Are you with me? Come on. This is far from the truth. And so, verse 17, and their sins and iniquities I remember no more. Would you please quit remembering them? God doesn't remember. You start saying, oh God, I know that was just a terrible thing. It's like, I don't know, I have a clue what you're talking about. But you know when I did this? No, I don't remember. But how about when I did that? No knowledge of it. I have no idea what you're talking about. Let's get on page with the Lord and start talking about the right thing instead of the wrong thing. Let's come with praise and thanksgiving instead of murmur and complaint. Murmur and complaint can get you, as long as you sit around feeling bad about yourself, you are in you and refusing to be in Christ. Why don't you recognize it and say, you know what, I'm done with me. I'm done with me. I'm fed up with me. I'm done. I'm going to be in Jesus. And now I'm going to start thinking about what it's like to be in Him. I'm going to start talking about hallelujah. Three claps, four hallelujahs, and, 100 wondering eyes. Please, go ahead, get excited about these things. Because once again, it's the first step of receiving it. It's the first step of receiving. You got to believe it. Good news. I just deposited $10 billion in your bank account. Would you look at me with the same kind of look sometimes as what I'm talking about? Good news. You're in Christ and He's in you. You're still looking at me with the same kind of look as though I just deposited $10 billion in your account. That unbelieving look. I want you to start grabbing hold of it and just be childlike and go ahead and believe these things. Is it true? Yes, it's this wondrous work of Christ, of what God has done for us. He's tired of hearing us go around and preach ourselves and talk about what we think about His salvation and what we think about the results of the work of grace and what we think about the new creation. It's time we start representing Him accurately and properly and declaring what He said about this work of grace, what He said about this great salvation, what He said about this wonderful thing that He's done in you and me. Hallelujah. 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 Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, so he says, verse 19, no sin, no iniquity. Yahoo! Come on in. He says to us, peace. He says, peace. That is the salamim. That is the only other offering besides Passover offering. The salamim sadak, or salamim offering, is what represents the communion or the Passover. Yes. this offering where we get to sit down and have fellowship with him and commune with him and eat with him and partake of that which he's partaking and have the right to sit at the table. He says, peace to those who are far away. He says, peace to those who are near and those who are far away. Before in the old covenant, he says, you can't come near me. Draw not nigh. Set bounds upon the mountain. You can't behold me. You're other than I am. I've given you a covenant. I've given you a covenant so that I might dwell in your midst. But only those, just a few people can approach unto me. That one that I anoint to be high priest, and he can appear before me once in a year. That's it. But now he says, everybody, come on in. He's saying, everybody. He says, this is just hateful to the Jew, because he says to the Jew and to the Scythian. So he says to those who are most close to him and to those Scythians who are the furthest one, to those who are most moral, to those who are most immoral. He said there is no difference, between the free and the bondwoman. There's no difference between the Greek, the barbarian, and the Jew. He said everybody has been given the equal right and privilege to now be washed in the blood. To be loose from their sins, Amen. To be forgiven by this wonderful act of grace, this wonderful work of the new covenant, ratified, brought to pass and established in the body and in the blood of Jesus. And when we have communion, this is what we're supposed to be doing. It's not supposed to be something other than that. And I don't want to go through the list. I want to go, Rabo Shekina Matea. I want you to get into the communion. I want you to get into the fellowship. I want you to recognize he's given to us the means that will sustain us, that we can live by. You know, even as the natural physical body is sustained by food and drink, so is the spiritual body by that which Jesus sacrificed for us at Calvary. Not by any works of righteousness which we have done, but because of his great love wherewith he loved us. He commended us to his love towards us while we were yet dead in our trespasses and sin. By grace are you saved. Hallelujah. The greatness of God's love and mercy. Here it is. Now come with all boldness into the holies of holies. And don't leave. Don't leave. And if you do leave, grab the blood and come back in. And don't stand there with your head hanging down like you have done something that gives you right to come in. All you've done is believed and taken the means, the right, by which has been given to you to have the right. The R-I-T-E that has given you the R-I-G-H-T to come in. Hey? Yes. Hallelujah. Borashambateke. The right of his blood. The sacrifice of the Lamb. Praise God. Father, you and I don't exist outside of Jesus. Will you get it through your head?
Yes.
Will you get it through your thinking? Your memory, would you remember? I don't even exist outside of Jesus. We have no existence outside of Jesus. He that hath the Son hath life. Does not have life. He's dead while he lives. Our whole existence in Jesus. It's amazing to me. I get so overwhelmed, intoxicated, caught away by the Word of God, and it seems to me there's so few people know how to get connected with the Word of God. It's amazing to me. And I don't really believe you have a right connection with the Holy Ghost unless you have a right connection with the Word. Because the Holy Ghost is all about the Word. He's all about revealing the Word. I've watched it. I've seen it. Like, it seems like people having a greater party in the kingdom of God without the Word of God. And that there's something wrong with that to me. That ain't right. That's off. I see people having all these various celebrations, and the Word of God is not the central piece of it. And that it doesn't produce within them a hunger for the Word of God. And that what I see is their doctrine and their position, their way of life and conduct and behavior and manner of life isn't what it's supposed to be. It's not developing to be in every way the conduct and character of Jesus Christ. And I say there's something wrong with that. I don't want nothing to do with that. Yeah. Hallelujah. I want the realms of the Holy Ghost that cause me hunger for the Word.
Yes.
I want the realms of the Holy Ghost that cause me hunger for righteousness.
Yes.
I don't want any other realm, because I know how Satan can mimic and counterfeit the realms of God's glory. I'm going to tell you right now, if the Word of God is not being produced as the fruit of whatever you're taking, what's ever going on in your life, stop it. Hallelujah. Because it's all about the Word of God being seen in our lives. When Jesus Christ is that Word. Hallelujah. The living Word and the conduct and character of Jesus. Listen to me. He should be there. There's nothing that should create greater excitement, greater joy, and greater thrill than these things that are revealed to us by the Word of God, because that's what the Holy Ghost is showing. I don't know what you're getting excited about, something else. Getting excited about no word? Huh? Are you listening to me? Yes. Get excited about just the moving of the Holy Spirit upon people's lives? Well, that's wonderful. But there's something far greater, and you need to mature into it to recognize it. The excitement that comes about the revelation of the Word of God, which is spirit and life and living and powerful. Hallelujah. Yes. Which is greater than anything else. Well, all heaven and earth can pass away. Not one little jot or tittle can fail. The Word of God, which represents and fully reveals the heart and mind and the will of the Father, who is manifested in the living Word, Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Are you listening to
yes.
me? Can anybody hear me?
Yes.
Amen. Get it right then. Make the adjustments necessary to begin to give the Word, Christ Jesus, the honor that He's due by giving the Word, the written Word, the honor that it should have in your life. And so we see here in verse 20, we come by the blood of Jesus Christ through a new and living way. Look at this, which He has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. So when we take a hold of the body, once again, He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. What are we looking at? We're looking at our means, the means by which we have to enter in, like the veil, passing through the veil. You had to pass through a means that separated God from all humanity. He's my means to now pass through that separation and now enter in with that blood that makes me. Because you could pass through the separation, you could pass through the veil. But if there was sin, if there was ungodliness, you are dead. But I walk in with boldness now and confidence that I'm going to be accepted and received and not rejected and cast out. Huh? I could, because you can look at Nadab and Abihu in Leviticus chapter 10. They walked in, and they walked in an unacceptable way, and they fell down dead. The fire of God struck them. And when the fire of God struck them, the scripture says that they were carried out by their tunics. The fire of God struck them in such a way that their bodies were not burned, nor their clothing were burned. The fire of God touched them, and it went right to the inward part of the being. And when the inward part of the being, and it had a very disastrous result.
Yes.
You listen to me. I want you to know, in the communion, there is a great blessing. There is. And people don't understand this, but in the communion and in the fellowship, there's also a curse. And people don't understand that. They go, what? There's a curse. Jesus said, if you drink and eat of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ unworthily, He said, you are guilty of His body and of His flesh. You're guilty of His death. He said, and people eat and drink damnation unto their souls. Huh? Think about that. And many are sick and sleep or die because of not taking a hold of it as we ought to. Because what we're doing is we're doing this in remembrance of Him. We're doing this in acceptance of what He's done for us and embracing the covenant. Say, this covenant is ours. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you the extreme. It's like somebody walking in and they don't care anything about God, or they don't care anything about the Lord Jesus. They don't care anything really about the message of salvation. They just hungry and thirsty. And they're having some meal. They're having some refreshments over here. Here, give me some of that. And really, that's really what the more crude or gross part of what Paul is addressing. But the Lord does, but you know, He does give us a challenge. He said, let every man examine himself. We need to examine ourselves.
Yes, yes.
And say, are we sincere about this?
Yes.
Are we just doing this religiously? Are we just doing because it's an activity? Are we doing this insincerely? Or is this something that we embrace the communion, we love the communion, we're happy about the fellowship, we're excited about the fellowship, and that's the lowest kinds of adjectives that we could use. This is an amazing thing. We're actually showing forth His death, partaking of His death, really celebrating the death, rejoicing in the death, and celebrating and proclaiming. We're proclaiming the death, and we're proclaiming His coming, because we do proclaim, show forth, what it really means to preach or to proclaim His death and His come until He comes. So we're also proclaiming our earnest expectation of His coming.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Elizabeth, why don't you and Allie Ann go over there and start pouring that out. I believe that more than anything, the fellowship and communion is all about love. Amen. Because it's love that poured it out. Yeah. There's an atmosphere of love that God wants to create. Understand this. Are you with me?
Yes.
Just recognizing the love that produced His body for us in the first place. The love of the Father. The God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. It has got to be a fellowship of love. I believe that one of the worst things that we could do against the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, against this wonderful fellowship, is to somehow have something else going on besides love. And I mean, that's one of the reasons I'm always looking at people going, telling them, I love you, and telling people, go tell people that you love them. Because if you're going to, if you want to move on in God, if you want to grow in God, if you want to fellowship with Him, you're going to have to be rooted and grounded in love. You're going to have to be willing to be connected. Every time God talks about any kind of growth, any kind of maturity, any kind of development, He's going to talk about it in the context of love. He's going to tell us we've been strengthened by the Spirit in our inner being, so that we can be rooted and grounded in love, so that we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto Him who is able to do superabundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to this power, this treasure that's on the earth, in this earth in vessels, the Spirit of the living God has come to dwell on the inside of us. Christ, the hope of glory, who's in us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He looks at us. Now you're able to grow up into Him, into all things. Who's the head? In this context of this love for the brethren, this call that the Lord Jesus Christ gave to us, He says, for us to love one another even as He's loved us. By this all men shall know that we are His disciples. This fundamental, beautiful thing called love. I mean, my goodness gracious, dear people, I want you to get out of the hate. I want you to get out of the dislike. I want you to get out of the moody blues. Huh? Moody. Happy, sad. Are you listening to me?
Yep.
I want you to get into this continuum. Rejoice evermore. Why don't you just obey that scripture?
Amen.
Why don't you just obey the scripture, all things give thanks. This is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, and all things you give thanks. Amen.
Amen.
Why don't you just listen to the exhortation at the end of the Philippians? Huh? You know, just, if it's good, think on these things. If there's praise in it, this is truth. Just all the wonderful things that we can find ourselves living in, to understand this love that has been given to us, to know this love that is above all other things. You can speak with the tongues of men and angels, have not loved, profits you nothing. You can have all faith so that you can move mountains, but you have no love, no profit. And then understand the beauty and the splendor of love, how that love is giving, how that love is a servant, how that love places no demand, how that love is so thankful, how that love is so grateful, how that love is so full of expectation all the time. All this beautiful, just, why don't you learn about love? So you can recognize when you have and don't have it. Why don't you get a little time studying about love while you're studying all them equations? While you're busy with whatever it is that's important to you that you valued in your life is important. God wants to readjust your values and readjust your thinking. Will you let Him?
Yes.
He's here. His glory is so powerful here. I wonder how I'm even standing here, not transfigured. You know, I've never experienced power and the glory of God in a greater way as I experienced through His Word. His Word, the declaration of His Word. I find that every one of His provisions are through the declaration of His Word. I find that His manifest presence through the declaration of words. As long as I'm talking about what God is doing and what God has said, I'm finding myself overwhelmed with the expressions of thanksgiving and joy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I want this section to stand up over here and come just receive this. And just put this over here and you guys can pile them up back there. Hakisena kolya sikana. Hakisena boki shikana mat. Exiporonaya tanda. Elima shikora moshi tande opona hai. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Serenaya. Pongeleste porinea tai. Bonjese kiste berinia. Hale monje. Kurashambo kinaya. Handeya. Hazabokarine shis. Kana mangdeya paya. Seto ramonteya kai. Zaydala. Hala monjeri. Hallelujah. Berenjeka. Hala vaseto yorosita. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise Setaramaya. Pokinaya. Sene Eshe. Praise God. Say thank you, Jesus. Ah, praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Hallelujah. Saying De Reshipate. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Happy? Say Ramandeka. Just praise Him. Praise. Just say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. A great, great praise, praise. That's an easy one. Say, just keep saying over it again. Hallelujah. Just start flowing out. Start just running off of your mouth like honey. Hallelujah. Henry Donjay, thank you, Jesus. Bless. You be blessed in Jesus' name. And you be blessed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Kere Mandeyosht, be blessed. Halatena, be blessed. Kere Mando, Shekeneshte. Hallelujah. It looks like I'm running out of tortillas here. Tikiristana, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. How are you? Bless you. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your goodness, for your mercy that endures forever. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, let your glorious love and light shine through your people. Father, I pray in Jesus' name. Almighty God, let the goodness of your Spirit be so radically manifested. This section, just come get in behind the line over here. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Hallelujah, in Jeremy's life, in Julie's life, in Yaakov's life, in Karen's life, in Dominique Faith's life. Which one are you supposed to call you? Both? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Do I have any more tortillas, or is this it? Is this it? Tako yanakeyate. Todamaya. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I would give you a big, gigantic piece, but here we go, buddy. How are you doing? Lord Jesus, I just thank you for touching Noah's body. Be blessed. Be blessed. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Bless you, dear. Hallelujah. Father, we just ask you, cause us to understand this. Thank you, Jesus. Cause us to understand, Lord. Father, I pray, Lord, your people begin to enjoy your presence like never before. I pray in the name of Jesus that not one single person be willing to spend a minute of the day without your presence. Amen, Nathan?
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love. Hallelujah. There's nothing so wonderful as this privilege of being able to live by Him. You know, when you get hungry, you know what you do usually? You go get some food. How you know that? And even when you're not hungry, sometimes you just go get some food that you know, the comfort foods, right? Mine is raisins and cheese. We just need to run to communion with Him, which is, this represents His presence, you see? It's the face bread in the Old Testament, or the bread of His presence. Communion with Him is just really experiencing His presence. And if you're groaning and complaining, I don't feel nothing, I feel bad, I feel empty and dead, nothing's going to happen in that. Just begin to thank Him for what He's done. You thank Him for the sacrifice that He paid at Calvary. Begin to praise Him for His goodness. Hallelujah. Ha. I say, I tell you right now, I promise you. You begin to praise him and you begin to give thanks in him for all the wonderful things that he's done to us and for us, the children of men. He will fill you. He will fill you. You begin to speak to him in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. He will fill you. You feel lonely? You feel overwhelmed? Just go to the rock. Go to the rock. The Holy Ghost will lead you to the rock. Can you just, everybody, just give me just a little smile, make me feel better? Encourage me by just smiling. Just smiling. I don't believe that anybody could see Jesus through a frown. I don't believe it. Jesus' body was like the veil that stood between the holies of holies and the holy place. You had to be a special group of people, born of a special family, to even be in the holy place to begin with. And here we stand. We're brought in to a realm of divine glory by the body of Jesus Christ that I want you, that God wants you to become aware of. So it just isn't form and ritual. Becomes a living reality that you can begin as you fellowship with the Lord tonight in the communion. As you look at these symbols, you can begin to recognize the spiritual reality that has been given to us. Now his body was broken so that we could step on in. The holies of holies hasn't been removed. The veil has been removed. Yeah. And on that, at that moment in time, when he hung there upon the cross, the scripture says that the veil of the temple was rent in two from the top and to the bottom as he died there on the tree, because his body was broken so that the blood might flow. Oh, so you and I might stand here in the presence of the Lord so that we can behold the glory. The Lord made loaves of unleavened bread, and there was 12 loaves, one for each tribe, one for each of the 12 tribes. It was in the holy place, and it was always in the holy place. And it was called the face bread, literally the bread of his presence. A bread of communion, an interaction, a fellowship with God that was a result of his presence. Like when God took the elders of Israel and he sat down and he broke bread with them and he ate. They had roast beef and bread and juice. Beautiful thing. Beautiful thing. And he's brought us into a spiritual fellowship with them and a communion with him that one day we'll get to experience as we have the fulfillment of this supper. And the marriage supper of the Lamb, it is going to be one glorious banquet and event. And I hasten to, my heart's filled with that. It's a reality to me. It's a date that I am aware of. I'm always aware of it. I just let God make me aware of it. And he makes us aware of it because we practice his presence. And we practice his presence just by being in his presence. Just by enjoying him. Just by recognizing him. Instead of recognizing all the problems and all the issues and all the circumstances and situations and negative things and slanders and all that the enemy's doing. I'm right, I see him. Amen. He's high and lifted up, and his glory fills the temple. Heaven and earth is sealed with his glory. How can you not see him? People look at this little small issue. They let themselves be focused on the minority of things, which is the little problems, when the overwhelming majority of that which is happening is glorious. Get out of the mess. Whatever the thing is, stop it now. Somebody said, how can I? Why don't you look to Jesus? Why don't you simply just look to the author and finisher of your faith? Yes. Communion is about just looking at Jesus. It's looking at the very being of Jesus and what he did so that you and I could fellowship with him. We're touching his body and touching his blood, and you can't look at him more closely than that. Why don't you just look into him, the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now set down at the right hand of the majesty on high, expecting until his enemies be made his footstool. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And that's just the way it's going to come down. Hallelujah. That's the way it is. That's just the way it is. And what's amazing is that Paul tells us, Ephesians 2:6, that we are seated together with him there. We are seated together with him in the heavenly. Heavenly. Do you know what heavenly is? It's a synonym for bliss. Ecstasy and joy and rejoicing, the heavenly. And it's also the reality of the presence of God, where there is joy forevermore. In his presence is fullness of joy. Hallelujah. I pray that you just give yourself to rejoicing forevermore. And those things that are stealing your joy, recognize that that's stuff you need to cut off. Quit fertilizing it and pruning it and trying to develop more fruit there. Amen. Just cut the hack, get the axe out and cut it down. Hallelujah. For us, we don't celebrate this once a year. Our Passover, we celebrate every day. And these times are just communion, and just celebrating his love for us. And I don't want you to get in doubt and unbelief. I want you to get in faith and confidence. Just believe that as we go through this season of continually having communion together, that your eyes begin to be open, that your heart begin to be touched by the beauty of this fellowship of love. But the beauty of God's commitment and covenant to us is unwavering commitment to his promise. The intimacy, the call for us to say, for me to live is Christ. That we thus judge, if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but live unto him who died for us and rose again. And I'm telling you right now, when we understand, when we say that we show forth his death, we're also saying, until he comes, we're also saying we're showing forth his resurrection. Because I guarantee you Paul wasn't leaving that out. We're showing forth his living presence. As I eat this, I'm saying he's in me. My bread of life is my provision to live. And he's in me. Watch this. See the bread? See this? No, you don't. It was out here. Now, where is it? That's why I said, take it and eat it. It's my body given for you. Take it. It's out here. Get it on the inside. Represents the lamb. Eat the lamb. That's a pretty good tortilla. It's tasty. Should be. No moldy bread. No lifeless white bread. You know what I'm saying? Filled with a bunch of leaven. This is unleavened. No sin. We're not here thinking about sin. We're thinking about righteousness.
Yeah.
We're in the covenant. Our sin and our iniquity been removed. People are like, oh, my sin. No. No. We're celebrating that our sins have been washed away. He bore our sins in his own
body.
That we now being dead to sin might live unto righteousness, by whose wound or stripes we were healed. Amen. Healed. See, there's a blessing in it. I'm recognizing my blessing. I'm not saying that there's some innate power for healing right now in this. I'm saying there's innate power in his body for healing right now all the time. And once again, remember, healing is what? The children's bread. The bread. The bread. The bread of heaven. The bread of provision. It's because it harkens back to the manna. They said, just give us a sign. Moses gave us manna in the wilderness. Jesus said, Moses did not give you the true manna. He said, I'm the manna. He said, I am the bread of life. Any man eat this bread, woo, what's he going to do? Living forever. I said it. I'm living forever. Listen, people can choose. They're going to die forever. And sometimes people need to hear that. Listen, buddy, you're going to die forever if you continue on like that. And God wants you to live forever. Listen, ma'am, I don't mean any disrespect, but I want you to tell you, you're going to die forever if you continue to believe that way and act that way. God wants you to live forever. He wants you to have a fellowship with Him. He wants you to come enter into the covenant that He's provided for you through His own body and blood. Come on now. Lord, make us bold. Make us bold. I heard the Lord speaking to me. It was either today or yesterday. Ask me for souls. Tell them to ask me for souls. Tell my people to start asking me for souls. Instead of complaining and wondering why they didn't get any. I'm just a failure. Start asking Father. He's the Lord of the harvest. Start asking Him. Start asking Him. Watch what God will do. See the bread?
Yes.
No, you don't. He's in me. Christ in me. Greater is He that's in me than He's in the world. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And in like manner, He took the cup and He gave thanks. Of course, we said that supposed to say that about the bread, gave thanks. The Eucharist. The giving of thanks. To bless. To give thanks. I thank you, Lord. That's to bless. I thank you, Lord. That you so loved me. That you gave me your only begotten Son. People, it won't take long for you to start talking to the Father like this on a daily basis, and these words will become real to you. God will make them real to you. They won't be lifeless. They won't be just words. They won't be words which you fail to grasp the meaning of. They'll become living to you. They'll become powerful to you. Let your communion always be giving of thanks. Just looking up towards heaven and giving thanks.
Yes.
That's fellowship. And He said, this is the new covenant in my blood. Think about the new covenant and all that it means. That your sins are completely erased for the remission of sins. Think about the new covenant. A new heart and a new spirit I will give to you. This life that is in the blood. For the life of the flesh, the scripture said, is in the blood. And here we discover that the whole life of our spirit, of our whole being, is found here in this life-giving power that is in the blood of Christ Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for what you did at Calvary. It's all symbols talking about Him bearing our sins in His body, Him offering Himself, taking upon Himself the sins of the whole world. Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world by taking upon to Himself all the sin and carrying it away so it could not ever return. Carrying it away is on the Day of Atonement, really, which is the day of purgation. The day of the removal of sin. Did you read about in Leviticus chapter 16? Carries it away so it can never return. Thank you, Jesus. And if you sin, we have an intercessor with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. He's the means by which it's erased and removed. If we sin, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This mercy is so great and such that if we sin again and again and again and again and again, 7 times 70 in a day, He'll forgive us. He'll forgive us, forgive us, forgive us, forgive us. So long as we're willing to forgive from my heart those who trespass against us. That's why you can't hold offense. That's why you can't hold unforgiveness. That's why you can't hold hurt. That's why you can't hold, which is the source of most of all sickness and pain and problem. Just forgive. You want to live an abundant life? Love everybody, forgive everybody, and bless everybody, and you're going to be happy. But he or she did something terrible to me, made me feel lower than a worm's belly. Or whatever the case may be. It don't matter. It don't even matter. What does that mean? When can the word of man, and even evil, reproachful men, be greater than the word of God? Why don't you make God's word greater to you than anybody else's word? Why don't you make God's favor for you greater than anybody else's favor? And then you remove yourself from the problem. Why don't you make God's blessing, God's provision, better than anything else you could have ever asked for? Then immediately you remove yourself from all the problems and all the cares of this life. Now you're able to cast all your cares upon Him, all your desires and all your wants, because He cares for you. Amen. He cares for you. He's going to take care. And here's the proof. Look at His love. Huh? If He so loved us, how much more should we love the brethren and be connected with them? Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. That's sweet. Isn't that satisfying? Man, give me another cup full kind of thing, right? Ah. The refreshing goodness of His grace. Everybody, would you stand with me? Would you stand up here with me? Hallelujah. 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 Well, those that you say, those of you who stayed at home watching on the web, sorry couldn't be here, have communion with us. But write down in the name of Jesus Christ, I send the word of God to you. Listen, I send the word of life. I want you to recognize with me that all sickness and all pain and all disease is not of God. It's a spirit. It's a spirit of death. It's a spirit of pain. And God, in Christ Jesus' name, has given us the authority to break off its yoke. Now, in the name of Jesus, if you're sick or diseased or hurting in your body, some problem in your body, you're being afflicted in your body or in your mind, those who are here with me, with us here in this congregation, those that are watching by web right now, I want you to understand that thing can be broken right now if you'll just believe. If you're not going to believe, it's not going to be broken. But if you'll believe with me right now, if you'll believe that the authority of Christ Jesus has not lost its power, that the name of Jesus is just as powerful as it's ever been, then that thing will be broken right now. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I break it. Satan, you listen to me. You take your affliction and you take your pain. And you take all those things that belong to your torment and you leave now. You go. Father, I thank you that you cause your people to understand how to live in your blessing. How to live in your divine provision so that they walk around in divine help. They walk around with a so caught away in your goodness that sin loses its appeal. Sin loses its attraction because we're just so attracted to you. Sin loses its pleasure because we're caught with pleasures forevermore in your presence. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let me just tell you what Father wants you to do. Let me tell you what He wants you to do. He wants you to learn to enjoy His presence. And if you're willing to just do what He wants you to do, every day you will grow in the realms of being able to enjoy His presence more. The more you give yourself to His manifest presence, the stronger His manifest presence becomes. I guarantee you, there's nothing that you could be laboring for with greater reward. Don't labor for the meat which perishes, but labor for that which endures unto eternity. Don't labor for other things, and don't put your interest, don't set your affections on earthly things, but set them upon things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. I guarantee you, God has a great reward in those and for those who seek Him. In seeking Him, the psalmist said in Psalms 19, seeking Him, there is a great reward. For without faith, it's impossible to please God. They that come to God must believe that He's here right now, that He's here, and that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. And I'm going to tell you what that reward is. His manifest presence. And I'm telling you, dear people, when you're caught away in His manifest presence, you listen to me. Faith becomes an all-time high. The working of God becomes as real and as continuous and as overwhelming as His Word describes. Amen.